It's 5 o'clock in Pirate Country, and it's time to get pumped up with the P-Man. Hit the door and hit the road. 94.3 The Game is going to get you home, and the P-Man's not holding back.
Yes! Yes! Pirates win! Pirates win!
Bring on the Patrick Johnson Show on 94.3 The Game.
Holy mackerel! Oh, my goodness!
The flagship station of the ECU Pirates.
All right. Hello, hello, hello. Welcome in. Nice to have you with us here. Patrick Johnson on the Patrick Johnson Show. PJ Show emanating from the top secret underground bunker today. We've got some more Pirates drafted, a proxy Pirate drafted, and I think we'll get to the Saban stuff today, possibly. There was another thing, and I don't know, Pilk, we'll discuss maybe with Brian Mull. Mull's going to come up. We'll talk the British Open, and we'll talk some golf with him. Pilk, did you – Philip R. F. Pilkey did producing the show here today. Pilk, did you – we talked about this yesterday briefly, and that was which, by the way, thanks to Mike Mullis. I got, like, a lot of Mully love yesterday from people. They loved having Mully on during the show. So let's we might have to twist Mully's arm to be a, like, a regular co-host or something. I don't know, because a lot of people like that yesterday. But Pilk, we had the discussion yesterday about why it's the British Open. Or the Open, not the British Open. That's what I think the conversation was. And apparently, because it's not necessarily in Britain every year, the preference is to call it the Open. Well, Pilk, you, like me, are a red-blooded American. So I'm going to call it the British Open. Because it's in the general area. Right? Did you know that, though?
Yeah, no, I knew that. The thing is, to me, look, Ireland, Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales, England, that's all the same to me. I couldn't care which one you're from. Look, once you get into those countries, I think you can move freely without getting a passport stamp. Therefore, they're the same place. They may have their own politics, own government. And for those people, that's fine. I get it. But for us in America, look, you're from across the pond, as they call it over there. You're from that little island up north of mainland Europe. It's all the same. It doesn't matter. It's all England. It's all Great Britain. It's all the UK. I don't know. I couldn't care less. It's the British Open.
But it's not. But it is the British Open. So we'll talk about that. Tiger with a great answer yesterday to a question about Colin Montgomery and retirement and that kind of thing. Pretty cool deal. Let's see here. Couple Pirates picked up yesterday in the draft. Is this thing over today, by the way, or is it finally over?
Yeah, it's over. They only do 20 rounds now, so actually it was over yesterday.
Wyatt Lunsford-Shinkman, taken in the 16th round, picked up by the Mariners. So I goes Mariners. At the time, he was the fifth Pirate drafted. Obviously, when healthy, well, I think we both agree with this, Pilk. Had Wyatt Lunsford-Shinkman in particular remained healthy, I think the Pirates would have had an excellent shot to get to Omaha. I do think all the pitching, or the key guys pitching wise, needed to be healthy. But Lunsford-Shinkman was key at the back end of that bullpen, and key out of the bullpen. So I think had he been healthy, the Pirates probably, well, they'd gotten to a super for sure, and probably got to Omaha.
Yeah, it would have been a total different story, especially when you look at that conference tournament weekend. And I understand the conference tournament didn't directly affect the Pirates' opportunity to go to Omaha, but I think it was kind of a domino effect when they struggled then, because over those five, six, how many ever games they played, you would have seen 5 to 7 really quality, high-leverage innings out of Wyatt Lunsford-Shinkman that you did not get. And at the end of the day, high leverage guys really have become the most important guy really in a staff right now. I mean, you had Danny Beal as a closer, and Danny's great, but there were a lot of innings. Danny can't go out there and pitch every inning, even though it felt like he did. Those high leverage guys, sixth, seventh inning, that's where games are won and lost in this era of college baseball and pro baseball.
Going to be interesting to see if Beal latches on professionally with somebody as an undrafted free agent contract kind of thing. So Lunsford Shinkman, I think we agree. And Zach Root falls into that too. Had Root and Lunsford Shinkman, that's the qualifier, been healthy. But if some butts were candy and nuts, every day would be Christmas, right? But Eric Ritchie got picked. And I think by the Phillies, which is interesting, 19th round. I think there's no denying Ritchie has the ability. Agree?
Agree.
I think a little bit of Ritchie's, oh, he's left-handed, so that helps. He's got ability and he's left-handed. But it's just the mental aspect of it, the focus aspect of it. Because his Ernie was pretty large. He was, you know, better than a strikeout an inning guy, marginally. But it just seemed like he had some times where he had lapses. Is that the best way to put it?
Yeah, it was like
up and down at times.
Yeah, his bad outings were just atrocious.
They were bad, yeah.
Yeah, but man, when you could count on him, when he was good, like you said, that upside, it's there.
When he's on, he's on.
Yeah.
So six players drafted. The previous high going back to 2019 was seven. And this could be, you know, a bit of a high watermark. It might be a minute before we see with the current, you know, rules, NIL and what have you, portal. This may be a minute before you see that kind of depth in a draft class out of ECU for it could be a bit. The JUCO player that they signed, Michael Carpenter, got drafted in the 11th round by the Twins. So that's a proxy pirate, right?
Yeah,
I think. I mean, he had signed with ECU. That counts, sort of. And he was a guy that was going to factor into the weekend rotation. I got to think he's a top 50 JUCO arm, so he had a tremendous deal this past season. So he's gone. Now do you go back into the portal and try to find a guy that could be a weekend starter? Is there a JUCO guy out there that remains? It may not be the quality of Carpenter. I think you'd be hard-pressed to find somebody the quality of Carpenter at this juncture, but stranger things have happened. Stranger things have happened indeed. Pilk, anything out of the draft, anything that surprised you out of the draft, or anything you think we may see? We mentioned Danny Beal. See if he gets picked up by somebody, undrafted free agent. I guess Jacob Starling, we'll see if that occurs with him too. I think Starling, I'm a big Starling believer. So I think he'll get a shot. Should get a shot at least, right? Should. Yeah,
I think he will. But to go back to your shocks about the draft, I wasn't really shocked to see Danny not get picked, but I was shocked to see Ritchie get picked over Danny, I guess. Just because Danny's
a lefty. He's a lefty. Ritchie's a lefty.
Yeah. But, hey, man, consistency's there with Beal.
I understand, but Richie's got some electric stuff. He's got that ability. Yeah, and, it's a late round. You take a shot on a guy like that.
Yeah. I was a little shocked to see JC go as high as he did just solely because he's a fifth-year player. And a lot of times they're trying to meet certain guys' signing bonuses for third-year guys, juniors coming out in that spot. So I was happy for him to go that early, but sometimes those fifth-year guys fall later than their talent shows just because they know they can get them in the later rounds a lot of times. So I was happy for JC, but a little shocked to see him go as early as he did.
No, I think like we talked about yesterday with Mike Mullis, his frame and what the measurables, he was probably taken at a slot where he can be quite productive. So That's the latest there. Pilk, did you watch the All-Star game any at all last night?
Yeah, I didn't sit through the entire nine innings, like volume on the whole time. But yes, I watched it, and it was on. It was in the background. I did see it all.
Got a lot of messages, DMs, texts, private messages about the uniforms and the stars on the uniform. I mean, it looked like something that a beer league softball team would wear. But it was fine. I mean, this is a TV show. That whole thing is a TV show, right?
It is. However, I find it weird. You know, used to they wore kind of the dopey uniforms on Monday night during the Derby, and the other All-Stars would also get those jerseys, and they would hang out, you know, with the players participating. And right. Then on Tuesday night, they would wear their normal uniforms, and then on the sleeve there, it would have the All-Star patch. I kind of liked that, but at the end of the day, like you said, look, I am one of those people. I hate those that it's for TV crap when it's a real game, but this isn't a real game. It is an All-Star game. It's an exhibition. Yeah. We're there to have fun. It's supposed to be an event. There's a reason this is the only game where I care about seeing the player intros and get to see the guys put the ball cat or the cowboy hats on the little kids and they get to high five. Man, it's fun. It's fun for the kids. It's fun to see Livy. It was good. It was fun to see Poppy in the dugout with a microphone interviewing players during the game. I mean, you hand a microphone to Poppy, you don't know what's going to happen. Yeah. So, yeah.
That was a smart thing to do. And that, to me, that I don't know if you could do that during the regular season, but like on Sunday Night Baseball where they talk to the players, there's nothing more annoying or counterproductive or uninteresting to me. I mean, occasionally there'll be maybe one answer during that interview where you're like, oh, that's interesting. But generally speaking, that is a clunky, bad interview. Take a page out of what they did last night from the All-Star game. I don't know who that character would be for ESPN, but Poppy in that role was great. Find somebody like that and put them in the dugout and let them do the one-on-one during the game with the guy, in between innings maybe. What do you think of that? Or yeah. Like if a guy makes a play in the field, you have Poppy or somebody. I don't know who ESPN would place in that role, but you put that kind of character, not Buster Olney. I'm talking like a guy who's the ex-player and let him talk to the player. You know, even if the other team's batting, do the split screen like we're doing here for our video audience, like ESPN is apt to do a million times. They shrink the game action and make the interview box, you know, big. During basketball, it's maddening. But, I mean, do that. I think that's that was brilliant. That's something that you could – even Fox needs to do that for when they get into the postseason. I thought that was great. That was fantastic.
I like it. I'm with you there. And you're right, ESPN hasn't started doing it, but obviously I watch, you know, majority of Red Sox games, and Ness and the Red Sox Network has started doing that, where they've started interviewing guys that clearly are not coming up to bat this inning, or a starting pitcher who pitched the day before, and they're kind of getting their inside scoop and almost kind of letting them announce what's going on too, and it's kind of fun. And yeah, they don't have someone down there interviewing them like Poppy was, but when you got like Kevin Millar in the booth or Kevin Youkilis, especially Millar, because we now know how much of a goofball he is, it still brings that fun one-on-one. And those guys, it's actually even better because they have chemistry with the announcers because they travel with these guys 162 days out of the year. It's fun.
I just think ESPN Sunday Night Bay, it just is – it's really, really, really struggled. And it's just not what it once was.
Patrick, anything Disney touches struggles. They ruined Star Wars. How do you ruin Star Wars? R2-D2, that's been called a he for 40 years, is all of a sudden a woman and a lesbian. Like, come on. It's been, that's what they're saying on this new show. It's like they've been calling him he for 40 years. And now, sorry, going off on point is everything Disney touches turns to crap. They're the opposite of King Midas. What did he touch turn to gold? What they touch turns to junk.
Let me tell you something about Disney, because I got Disney checks for a little bit. That check comes from the mouse. It's on. You can set your watch to it, baby. That mouse money comes on time to the mailbox. You don't have to worry about it. It's as solid as a dollar. All right, we're going to talk some golf and some golf bets. Our pal Brian Mull will join us tomorrow. We're looking forward to having Kurt Kraft in the studio. He recently announced his retirement as the director of the track and field cross country programs at ECU. So looking forward to that. That is tomorrow. But next, Brian Mull joins the Patrick Johnson Show. Don't you go away.
Summer savings event is on at Greenville Toyota.
Enjoy your summer in a new Corolla for just $219 a month or a Highlander for only $399 a month. Got a trade? Get cash for it on the spot or trade for a new Toyota.
At Greenville Toyota.
Acre Station Meat Farm, along with Lane Angus Beef, bring you Farm to Fork Beef.
Stock your freezers now with affordable beef boxes just in time for the grilling season.
Farm to Fork Beef brings quality local beef to your family. From your traditional butcher shop, Acre Station Meat Farm. Come on down to Acre Station Meat Farm and find out why we're number one in fresh cuts and friendly service.
Acre Station Meat Farm, Highway 32 North, Pinetown.
Other restaurants claim their food is fresh and fast, but are they friendly? At Moore's, you're treated like family the minute you walk into their doors. With locations in Winterville, New Bern, Swansboro, Moorhead City, and Jacksonville, we've been practicing what we preach since 1945. At Moore's, our barbecue is slow-cooked and smoked over real wood daily until it's so tender it's falling off the bone. Combined with our fresh chicken, cooked-to-order seafood, and homemade fixins, we're sure you'll agree. If it's not Moore's, it's less.
You know what the problem is with standard belts? Usually you have to choose between too tight or the opposite, too loose. But with Anson Belt and Buckle, you don't have to choose. We got rid of the holes and instead have a track system designed for micro-adjustability. That way you can enjoy a perfect fit every time. Anson Belt and Buckle. Find your perfect fit today.
She fine, hoping she can sing it to me one more time. Get low, get low, get low, get low.
Grab a Pepsi Wild Cherry
and get wild.
When a place is as special as this, you don't want to change a thing. You simply want to enjoy it just as it is. That was our inspiration behind Bow Coast West, our newest community in Beaufort, North Carolina. Embrace all that we love about this very special place and make it easy for families to enjoy all that this coastal lifestyle has to offer. Be inspired. Bow Coast West.
Get to Greenville Toyota for summer savings.
Lease new RAV4s, $319 a month. Test drive the redesigned 2025 Camry. In stock and ready for delivery. All with our advantage.
At Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
Sometimes you just don't know if you want to kiss him
or slap him.
Ow!
Either way, he'd probably like it.
The Patrick Johnson Show on 94.3 The Game.
All right, welcome back in. It's great to have you with us here. East Carolina weight loss down 2 more pounds at my weigh-in last week. On my scales here, I was down a little over a pound from a couple days ago. And I'm feeling great. I'm able to walk. I'm able to get out and exercise. You don't necessarily have to do that to have success with East Carolina weight loss, but you can, and you'll probably find yourself wanting to do more things like that because, you just won't feel as what's the way to put it, prohibited. Is that a way to put it? That might be the way to put it, yeah. So down over 50 pounds, close to a double nickel, not quite there. Really going to have to knuckle down to get my goal by Labor Day now, but I think I'm going to be able to do it. 252-496-3610. Folks are still calling. 252-496-3610. or eastcarolinaweightloss.com. The good news about this is, again, you don't have to exercise, but I walk probably 5 days a week, at least 35 minutes, probably 40 to 45 minutes most days. I've got, when I'm not at the beach now, a routine and some trails picked out that I can walk on and hit my goals. But you can lose up to 20 or 30 pounds in the first couple of months. No counting calories, no prepackaged meals. You're not counting points, no drugs, no surgery, no shots. You know, I know some people have sworn by the shots, but the shots bother a lot of people. So East Carolina Weight Loss, give them a call today or go online. Tell them the great P-Man, Patrick Johnson, sent you. All right, Pilk, we got Mull. There he is. Ladies and gentlemen, Brian Mull joins us from the Port City, looking quite good himself. He's a fit as a fiddle young man in this day and age there. My friend, how are you? What's going on?
I'm doing well, Patrick. Finally getting some rain. It's not 115 degrees or whatever it's been for the last week. A little gray and rainy today, and which is fitting with the Open Championship on the horizon, because I think there is quite a bit of rain and gray skies in the forecast, with a little bit of sun and maybe, if we're lucky, a little bit of wind. I think we may see it all in the next 4 days over at Troon on the west coast of Scotland.
That's what you hope to see when you have the British Open, is you hope that there will be awful weather. Because that's the star of the show. You would like a day with, but here's the beautiful thing about, you know, over there when they play this event, you could have a few hours like in the morning where the weather's beautiful, and then the afternoon everything goes to pot weather-wise, or vice versa. You could have terrible conditions in the morning, and the afternoon conditions could be greatly improved. And I mean, you're looking at wide swaths of temperature swings possible, so. It's intriguing in that regard to me. Let's look at our major winners so far. Scottie Scheffler, Bryson DeChambeau, and one of your favorites, Xander Schauffele, who for two or three years, if we all could find somebody to love us like Mull loves Xander Schauffele, we'll be lucky. But Mull has been off the Schauffele thing for the last year and a half. But he won. He got his major. I was happy to see him in a way win, because it was great to see DeChambeau come back and win the U.S. Open. DeChambeau, to me, is the guy who's been the most consistent in these events. Scheffler is, you know, fantastic and is apt to win at any moment. Of those three major winners, which one of those three do you think has the best chance to perform well this week?
That's a great question. I feel like Scotty, although he is the odds-on favorite, has been a little bit under the radar because of his disappointing performance in Pinehurst and the fact that he did not play last week when most guys did at the Scottish Open. Took some time off. That being said, he was in Scotland playing golf. He was just playing some of the other links courses to get acclimated to the conditions. But what Bryson's done has been incredible. I mean, we could kind of feel it coming toward the end of last year. It was a crime that he wasn't one of the 12 Americans that went over to Paris to represent the United States in the Ryder Cup. But it was a travesty. Hopefully something like that won't happen again. And then, you know, I think when he was in contention at Augusta and finished sixth there, that really opened a lot of eyes, because that was a place where he had struggled throughout his career, even when he went there as the U.S. Open champion in 2020. Xander's consistency, I mean, look, I know he's kind of in a punchline on this show, but he's had 11 straight top 20s in majors. And when you think about that, that was done on 9 different golf courses. That's remarkable. He's finishing the top 20 in the U.S. Open every year. He has a very good record in the Open. He had an opportunity to win it a couple of years ago when Francesco Molinari did it at Carnoustie. It's going to be interesting. Bryson's going to have to take a different tactic here. If he drives the ball as poorly as he did at Pinehurst, he'll have a hard time. He was very fortunate with some of the tee shots he hit, particularly on Sunday, that he always seemed to get a good break. That will not happen at Troon. He'll be in a bunker and have him pitching out sideways and taking, you know, basically that's a penalty shot. I like Xander this week to be in contention, but I feel like, I don't feel like any of those three guys is going to win.
Okay. Well, again, out of those three, which maybe stood the best chance, we'll get to who you think could win this in a little bit. If betting were legal, and it is, I would not personally wager a nickel, a shiny nickel, on Rory McIlroy. But Vegas right now and all the books, oh, it's like Christmas. Because there are suckers out there who are going to buy the Rory hype.
People love to bet on Rory in majors. And if you've been doing that for the last 10 years, it's been a rough stretch.
You hadn't made any money.
He led, now in placement markets, but not to win. And he was leading the field or close to leading the field in tee to green last week in Scotland at the Scottish Open. He said that, you know, he had some trouble acclimating. The greens are obviously much slower over there because of the conditions that can come in. And that is an adjustment. You know, even though Rory is from Ireland, he plays most of his golf in America now, where the greens are much faster. So he feels like he's made that adjustment. He feels like he's in a good headspace. He's getting the same questions at the press conference that we're used to him getting, which, you know, has to put some strain on him mentally. There's obviously some pressure, but you know, in his own words, he has been in the hunt quite a bit in the last few years. He just hasn't been able to close the deal. I never know what to make of Rory. It doesn't surprise me when he plays well, and it doesn't surprise me when he plays poorly in these events. I think he's you know, if he's gotten over the just utter devastation of the way he spent the last hour in Pinehurst last month, I think he should contend this week. There's no question. His game and comfortability on links golf courses, but he's a real wild card for somebody who's ranked so highly in the world and thought of so highly in the Vegas market. Like he is a real wild card to me. It would not surprise me if he contended, and it really wouldn't surprise me if he missed the cut.
Rory's North Carolina story is quite interesting this year because he wins in Charlotte, files for divorce, goes to Pinehurst, loses, flies back down to Florida instead of somewhere else, and finds himself, I guess, during this time period of period off, or maybe he and his wife have decided to not go forth with that. So, I mean, yeah. Look, these guys are just like the listeners out there, they're like you and me. I mean, they have private lives or personal lives. They have things that weigh on them. You know, we all have issues. But it just seems to me, boy, there just seems like there's a lot of volatility for him away from golf right now.
Yeah, not to turn this into an episode of TMZ, but two things that stood out from his press conference to me yesterday was he mentioned that he changed his cell phone number 2 days after that U.S. Open, and that therefore did not receive a text that Tiger had sent him, but they had chatted this week, and he wasn't wearing his wedding ring. So, you know, make of those facts what you will. A lot of golfers take their ring off when they play golf, put it in the bag, and so, I mean, that's probably possibly not a big deal, but you just wonder, yeah, how things, it's been a tumultuous month or so for him away from the golf course, and you just wonder really where he's at. Rory's very good at saying the right things in public, but you have to have a clear head and you have to have a great attitude. I think that's been a common theme in the interviews this week, and if you look at the players who have performed well over there, you have to have a good attitude because you're going to get some funny bounces on a links golf course. You're going to have a stretch where the weather is not your friend. You might be on that wrong side of that draw, or a squall could come in and you have to play three or four holes in just miserable weather. And you never know really when that's going to happen. So the players who have a good attitude or allow able to allow those things to kind of roll off their shoulders will perform the best this week. And obviously, you know, through history, just ball strikers rise to the top after four rounds in this golf tournament. I mean, you just can't fake it at all around these links courses. There's a lot of different ways to get it done through the air, on the ground. You know, we've seen older players contend in this major as much as any other. But Rory's a fascinating case. I mean, to think that in 2014 he won two majors to get to four, and he's still stuck on four. It's really hard to process.
We're talking to Brian Mull, golf writer extraordinaire. He's also up to his neck in preseason basketball writing right now for Lindy's and Blue Ribbon and all of that. He's got all that going on. Hey, Brian, as far as Tiger goes, this is an event that I think the two events he's always going to be able to have even a puncher's chance in is going to be Augusta, because he knows how to play that course, as we saw a handful of years ago. And I mean, a lot of things would have to go right, but if he can catch lightning in a bottle, he knows the course. And then the way that you have to play these links courses seems to play right into his hands.
Yeah, there's no question. As he mentioned yesterday, you know, as golfers get older, they don't carry the ball as far, and so much of American golf and modern golf around the world, the ability to carry your driver 310, 320 yards is just a huge asset and allows you to just shrink these golf courses to a point where you can score. But over there, even with the rain that they have had, they've had a pretty wet summer. The ball is still going to run, especially downwind. He mentioned being able to shape the ball and hit it low and chase it down the fairways. And we have seen just in the last 10 or 15 years, the Tom Watson, at age 59, Greg Norman at contend on Sunday in his 50s. We've seen other veteran golfers continue to play well. Ernie Els is a guy. I mean, he's won three times on the Champions Tour in the last 6 weeks. He's won two British Opens. I mean, he's a guy who I think could certainly get hot this week. But, with Tiger, it's just how's his body going to hold up? I know it's the same old story, but he says that he has been training better. He's been able to do things on the golf course in the last month or so that he had not been able to do all year. So we'll just have to see. I do agree with you that, like, as far as making the cut, the Masters and the British Open are his two best chances. This tournament means a lot to him. He understands his place in the history of this event. And it wouldn't, you know, a good week for him, it would be a top 25, top 30 finish. And he's certainly capable of doing that. I do think as you get older too, the slower greens are something you can handle a little bit easier. We saw Adam Scott, who has struggled for most of the last year or so, come within a shot of forcing a playoff at the Scottish Open last week in his mid-40s.
All right, could you hang through a break here? Could we get Pilk on and let him do an update, and then we'll get some picks? And I got a couple other questions for you. So the great Brian Mull hanging out with us here on the Patrick Johnson Show today. Right now, Philip the Ref Pilkington, our esteemed producer and anchor and co-host with a 94.3 The Game Sports Update and Pirate Report. Pilk, what you got?
Thank you, P-Man. And starting with the MLB draft, there were some more Pirate players drafted as Wyatt Lumford-Shinkton went in the 16th round to the Seattle Mariners, and Eric Ritchie was taken in the 19th round by the Philadelphia Phillies. Also, JUCO signee Michael Carpenter was taken by the Twins in the 11th round. Last night, the American League won the 94th MLB All-Star Game 5-3 in come-from-behind fashion, and big thanks to Red Sox Jaron Duran, who hit a two-run homer In the fifth, to put the AL on top, Duran was given the All-Star Game MVP honors. The A's' Mason Miller was credited with the win, while the Reds' Hunter Green was given the loss. Guardians' Emmanuel Clase got the save. And former Pirate pitcher Jeff Hoffman did come in and throw one-third of an inning, throwing just four pitches. That'll do it for your 94.3 The Game Sports Flash Update and Pirate Report. We're going to take a quick time out here on the Patrick Johnson Show and be back with more of preview of the Open Championship with Brian Mull on the other side.
Hi, I'm D.R. Alligood.
And I'm his daughter, Jessica.
For 11 years, we have built quality driveways and parking lots for both your residential and commercial needs. We also offer free on-site quotes to have your custom driveways built the way you want.
252-946-1227.
About you, your family, and the health of all who live in Eastern North Carolina. This is about the transformation of a health system into something more powerful and more human, about creating new ways to treat disease and keep you well. This is about ECU Health, which is to say, it's really all about you. ECU Health, minds, hearts, purpose.
You know what the problem is with standard belts? Usually you have to choose between too tight or the opposite, too loose. But with Anson Belt and Buckle, you don't have to choose. We got rid of the holes and instead have a track system designed for micro adjustability. That way you can enjoy a perfect fit every time. Anson Belt and Buckle. Find your perfect fit today.
Your confidence makes everything look good. You see the world in vivid color, not black and white. Swing through your neighborhood Fantastic Sam's Cut and Color and let our experienced stylist take you from everyday to extraordinary.
Fantastic Sam's hair salons are locally owned and operated. Our full-service salons are conveniently located in Goldsboro, Kinston, Greenville, New Bern, Jacksonville, and Calabash. Stop in today at Fantastic Sam's, where the possibilities are endless.
Hi, I'm D.R. Alligood.
And I'm his daughter, Jessica.
For 11 years, we have built quality driveways and parking lots for both your residential and commercial needs. We also offer free on-site quotes to have your custom driveways built the way you want.
252-946-1227.
Taking the rage out of your drive home.
You just cut me off, but it's no big deal.
Patrick Johnson on 94.3 The Game and the new IBX Media app.
Brian Mull joining us here. We're going to get some picks for the Open Championship, which starts at 1:35 in the morning because they're at Royal Troon, which is overseas. It's in Europa. All right, Brian, Colin Montgomery, I guess, was bemoaning. Imagine this. Colin Montgomery was griping about something. I guess, was there a senior event there last week or something? But he was basically saying, you know, what am I doing out here, that kind of thing. And I guess a reporter posed this question to the big cat yesterday. And Tiger's like, well, I've won this event, so I'm at least exempt till I'm 60. I mean, I don't think I'm giving the proper context to this, but if you're an old head kind of like you and I are, that, you know, the Greg Norman Tiger thing has always been there, but the Montgomery Tiger thing has always been there too, hasn't it?
Oh, no doubt. You just go back to the epic 12-shot victory there in the 1997 Masters when Tiger burst onto the scene to win his first professional major. And, I mean, Colin Montgomery was top two or three player in the world and was somewhat in the hunt and thought he had a chance going to Saturday, even though he was five or six back, and then it was quickly just obliterated, and that set a tone for what would happen on the golf course. Monty, certainly one of the better players of any era, not to win a major championship, just completely squandered an opportunity there in 2006 at Wingfoot. It's probably his best chance, U.S. Open, and was a bridesmaid many times and not in Tiger's class. And I think maybe, you know, there's a couple ways to look at those comments. The comments are maybe taken a little bit out of context. At least that's what Monty is now claiming on Twitter, as he wished Tiger good luck this week. But Tiger never won to back down from an opportunity to take a jab at Monty. He's a pretty easy target. And, you know, Tiger's right. Like, he's earned the right to play until he's 60, the way the current rules of the British Open are set up for former champions. Monty, with all of his success, winning the Order of Merit on the European Tour for many, many years in a row, never was able to get across the line. And Troon was one of his more disappointing finishes, considering that's where he grew up. So, you know, is Tiger still a threat? Should he be playing? That's totally up to him. If he wants to try to tee it up four times a year, four or five times a year, as he's done the last couple of years, he certainly earned that right. People are going to watch him play. People were out there Sunday following his every move as he played a practice round by himself. And you know, we saw Nicklaus and Palmer in another era do this well into the, you know, well past the point where they could contend, but it was a ceremonial, and the Tiger would never use that word. But that's basically what he is at this point. You know, we're just all hoping for a glimpse, I think, a flash of nine holes or just a little stretch of vintage Tiger. But to think that he could sustain it over 72 holes is pretty unrealistic.
Everybody gives the LIV guys grief because of the 54 holes. Some of the courses they play are not exactly challenging. They're coming off a week, though, where their tour was in Europe. They played a really representative course, I believe, in Spain. So who are some of the LIV guys that you think might be of value, let's say, as we start to turn our attention to that part of the conversation? Who are some LIV guys that would be of some value this week if you want to lay a little action before things tee off this morning?
I think Louis Oosthuizen is a guy that we used to just pencil in for top 25s and majors. You know, Louis a little long in the tooth as well, but he has really started to show some good results, some good form on LIV. He was in contention last week right up until the end, and he's, you know, plus 225, plus 250 to top 20. I certainly think with his precision off the tee, which is going to be important this week, and the ability to avoid those bunkers and play from the fairway and just kind of plod along and stay steady, I think that certainly he is someone who has shown that he is capable of that. When you go a little deeper, Dean Burmester is a guy that, you know, has primarily played the European Tour before he joined LIV, but he has performed well at the majors this year as well. And I think that he could be another name to kind of keep an eye on. Of course, all eyes will be on Bryson. And then what do we do with Jon Rahm, who says he's healthy, says that he was thinking about his golf swing too much. He's had the worst year of his career in the majors. He's not been a factor in any of the first three, which is totally unusual. And it's very easy to point and say, well, he took the money bag and, you know, he's not the same player. He had a foot injury, which caused him to miss the U.S. Open at Pinehurst. But, you know, he has fallen down the board considerably, considering, you know, he was one of the top two or three favorites in all these majors just a year ago. So if you were willing to if you like good odds, I mean, these are probably the best odds that you'll ever have on John Rahm. And I wouldn't be opposed to a sprinkle on Rahm to be a factor this week. And, you know, when guys are that talented, it doesn't take much for it to click. And then if it clicks a little, you know, kind of as we saw with Victor Hovland at the PGA, he had struggled coming in there, but he found a little something in his golf swing. And then once he got a taste of it and got in the hunt, he didn't back down. And he was in the golf tournament until the 72nd hole. So John Rahm, a two-time major champion, could certainly be in the mix Sunday. And I don't think anyone would be surprised.
Maybe a placement with Rahm there. I think all those guys are placement. I mean, DeChambeau, obviously, you might put a little something on him. You mentioned Scheffler already. Who else do you think has a really likely shot to win this and or maybe a good value for anybody out there that wants to put a little something on the Open?
Yeah, I'll be honest, the Open Championship is an event where if you don't have a strong feeling going in, it's not the worst tournament to live bet because of the variables with the weather. And, you know, if you can follow the weather a little bit and get an idea for the forecast and see who has an advantage, that's something the markets aren't going to be able to pick up on. So it's almost a tournament where if you wake up in the morning and you kind of get a feeling for how the course is playing, you can, the odds will shake out and adjust a little bit. But if there's not a ton of wind, which I don't think there's going to be like crazy wind. I mean, you know, there's going to be 10, 15 miles an hour. That's pretty standard. I think Morikawa is worth a sprinkle. I mean, he's an Open champion and you can find him, you know, 16, 18 to one. I don't think that's the worst play at all. And then an intriguing one to me, and I'm a sucker for him in the majors, is Koepka, who has dipped down around 40 to one. That just is insane to me for a five-time major champion. I think there's some value there. I do not like Ludvig. I'm not going to bet on Tommy Fleetwood to win a golf tournament. Tyrrell Hatton's kind of in the same boat. Like, you know, he's top 10 favorite to win. And I don't feel great about that. You know, do we believe in Patrick Cantlay? He's finished top five in his last two events, but hadn't played in a month. You know, he looked very good at the U.S. Open. It was his best major finish yet. And he's also down around that 40 to one mark. You know, he's got the right demeanor, I think, for a major and being able to, and certainly has an all-around game comparable to Schauffele. Maybe distracted a little bit by his role on the PGA policy board this year, but maybe able to kind of lock in for 4 days. It's a good one to live bet. I just think that you can find some value as the tournament unfolds.
I was going to ask you that. I mean, is this one of those deals too where, you know, maybe you wait till the first two rounds are in the books? I mean, can you still do pretty well if you maybe bet the weekend?
Yeah, I mean, unless somebody's got a five or six shot lead after 36 holes, I mean, you're still going to be able to pick a winner on plus money and be able to wake up Sunday morning and grab a cup of coffee and have a little bit of a sweat, which is, you know, what we're all hoping for. I think that looking at even, you know, mid-round, second round, or certainly through 36 holes, you could identify the guys that you feel like are striking. I always try to look, you know, in tournament for the guys that are striking the ball well and maybe have had one bad hole where they got an unlucky break or you know, hit an errant shot, but just haven't really holed the putts yet. And, you know, you're trying to find that guy that you feel like can, you know, has what it takes internally to hang around on the weekend, but also can get a hot putter on the weekend.
Hey, Brian, thanks a lot. Always great to talk to you. Good stuff. We'll see how it all plays out.
Okay. Thanks, Patrick. Everybody enjoy the tournament. Have a great weekend.
We'll be back to wrap up the show and tell you about tomorrow's program and the rest of the week right after this.
Air Service is back at Pitt Greenville Airport, offering safe, clean facilities and flights from American Airlines. That means the short commute, quicker lines, and better prices that get you where you're going fast and easy. See it for yourself. There's great things inside at Pitt Greenville Airport. Storm season is approaching. North Carolina weather can damage your roof, and before long, a small leak can turn into a big problem. Your home is one of your biggest investments, so protect it with Wells Home Improvements.
We work with all insurance companies for a hassle-free roof installation experience. Call us today and get 10% off your roof installation when you mention this commercial.
252-227-8403 or visit us online at wellshomeimprovements.com. Wells Home Improvements. Local. Honest. Dependable.
Big tax credits are back. Get a 30% tax credit, up to $2,000 off your new Mitsubishi electric heat pump install. Let Comfort Master help you take advantage of the tax credits with a qualifying Mitsubishi electric ducted heat pump or non-ducted Mitsubishi electric mini splits. Mitsubishi electric mini splits are ideal for bonus rooms, garages, or sunrooms. If you need a new HVAC unit, call Comfort Master today.
Call Comfort Master. Call Comfort Master.
When a place is as special as this, you don't want to change a thing. You simply want to enjoy it, just as it is. That was our inspiration behind Bow Coast West, our newest community in Beaufort, North Carolina. Embrace all that we love about this very special place, and make it easy for families to enjoy all that this coastal lifestyle has to offer. Be inspired. Bow Coast West.
Let's go!
Woo! Woo! Yeah! Woo! Football time!
Set the tone! Kyle, tie your shoes, tie your shoes. Yeah, good job!
Woo! Yeah!
Grab a Pepsi Wild Cherry and get wild.
Acre Station Meat Farm, along with Lane Angus Beef, bring you Farm to Fork Beef.
Stock your freezers now with affordable beef boxes just in time for the grilling season.
Farm to Fork Beef brings quality local beef to your family. From your traditional butcher shop, Acre Station Meat Farm. Come on down to Acre Station Meat Farm and find out why we're number one in fresh cuts and friendly service.
Acre Station Meat Farm, Highway 32 North, Pinetown.
Air Service is back at Pitt Greenville Airport, offering safe, clean facilities and flights from American Airlines. That means the short commute, quicker lines, and better prices that get you where you're going fast and easy. See it for yourself. There's great things inside at Pitt Greenville Airport.
And now, the stunning conclusion of the show. It's the P-Man here on 94.3 The Game.
All right, good stuff from Mull. I think he's spot on there. I think this is one of those you might wait and see who makes the cut, and then if you're going to lay any money down on it, maybe do it before play starts on whatever it is, I guess Friday into Saturday, right, Pilk? I mean, that would seem to make the most sense. Kind of live betting it, as Brian said. Because this is such a tough one to pick. I mean, no, it's rare that the guys that you saw who won in these other events come back and win in this event. The guy that Cam Smith won it a couple of years ago, and he seemed to be, he's a foreign guy. I don't know. It seems like this event has the most surprise winners. This one tends to. Maybe it just seems like that.
It kind of does, and I think a lot of that, in kind of to Brian's point there, because he said it without saying it, is the weather. And, you know, if the weatherman could predict the weather, like he said, the books will not really affect that or will not really show what the weather is doing.
Right.
You could bet before, right? You could say, hey, you know what, guys who tee off in the afternoon on Thursday and the morning on Friday are going to have better weather than the opposite. You know, I don't know. I haven't looked at the weather. And then you would feel good about betting one of those guys, say, top 10, top 20, just because you feel like they stand a better chance to make the cut. But the problem is the weatherman can't predict the weather here, and the last place you can predict it is over there in Lynx Golf. And, yeah, I'm kind of with Brian here. Friday night before you go to bed, do a little research and then make your play.
But sea levels. All right, I'm gonna lay off that. That's a whole other battle I'm having on social media. Speaking of sports betting. Jason Sane, one of the most, probably the most powerful, one of the most powerful lawmakers in North Carolina, high-ranking House official, announced that he is resigning from his post in effective August 12th. He's going to get out of lawmaking. I think it's been really frustrating for Jason. He was the one that pushed through and shepherded through sports betting, legalized sports betting in North Carolina. So that is a legacy he'll forever have. But he's getting out. I think he finds the process in Raleigh frustrating. Jason is a doer and a high energy alpha. And I think that's part of the reason why he's frustrated, because that ain't politics.
It's sitting on your butt and collecting a paycheck is what politics is.
Well, and that's the other thing. They make such little money to be a state lawmaker. It's almost impossible to have another career. And, you know, he's got a kid that's in high school and, you know, I think fairly active in athletics. And he talked about he and his son were starting a business together, in fact. So, I mean, I just think Jason is, it's time for him to make some money. And anyway, well, good luck to him. He does believe that this bill would have NC State and North Carolina play East Carolina, App State, and Charlotte still has a lot of support. Even though he may not be there to see it through, there's still a lot of support for that. So thanks to Brian Mull. Tomorrow, Kurt Kraft will be with us. He announced his retirement yesterday. And Coach Kraft, who will retire, speaking of people ending their tenure, will retire effective mid-September, will be a guest on the Patrick Johnson Show. But thanks to Brian Mull today. Thank you, Pilk. See you in the morning on Talk of the Town, our Crime Stoppers Radiothon tomorrow from Greenville's Gathering Place, the brand-new cafe there. And back here with Coach Kraft tomorrow on the Patrick Johnson Show at 5. Best of coming your way on Friday. Have a great evening, everybody.